Hello students, a very happy morning to all of you. Welcome to Science Online Learning. In our previous class, we studied about the components of the environment and interdependence in nature and balance in nature. And without this balance, the environment would get destroyed. We also discussed how nature maintains a balance of gases, balance between the organisms, balance of soil minerals, and about water cycle. Students, we are going to start today's session with a quick recap of what we have already learned in our previous class. We studied that the surroundings in which an organism lives is called its environment. And it consists of the air, the soil, the climate, plants and the animals. It also includes the people around a person and the interaction of the person with these people. And what are the components of environment? Yes, they are biotic component and abiotic component. The biotic component of the environment is made up of living beings. So all the plants, animals and microorganisms make up the biotic component of the environment, whereas the non-biotic or abiotic component of the environment is made up of non-living things such as air, water, soil and light. And all these things that make up the environment are connected to each other or they depend on each other. So that's why we say that they are interdependent. And this process of linking together of plants and animals by a process of eating and being eaten is called the food chain. And the most common example is grasshoppers eat plants, whereas mice eat the grasshoppers and owls eat mice. Next, we studied that all the things that make up the environment, they not only depend on each other, but they maintain a perfect balance between each other. Nature maintains the balance of gas, balance of minerals in the soil and even the balance between the organisms. And the nature's way of maintaining the balance of water is through a process called as water cycle. So what is water cycle? The continual movement of water from the earth to the air and back to the earth is called as water cycle. And without this, the soil would become dry and the plants, the animals and also we human would not have water. Children, today we are going to learn lesson 10, natural resources in your science class. You can turn your textbooks to page number 53, okay, 53 in your textbook. What is meant by resources? Resources are the things we use in our day-to-day life. For example, money, machines, land are all resources. And all the natural things we use are called natural resources because they come from nature. For example, air, water, soil, rocks, fuels, plants and animals are all natural resources. So in this lesson, we'll be learning in detail about the natural resources. First, let's see how forests and grasslands are helpful to us. So children, do you know how forests and grasslands are useful to us? Yes, forest provides us wood. We get wood from large trees, from the trunk of large trees, we get wood and timber. And even the small stems are useful as firewoods. And lots of medicines are prepared from the various parts of plants. People graze farm animals on the grasslands and in the forest, and we also collect fruits, the roots which are having lots of medicinal values. We get honey from forests, we get bamboo and many other useful things from the forest. And the other important thing is forest and grasslands are the natural home of wild animals. So many wild animals live in the forest. So forests provide shelter to the wild animals. They maintain the balance of gases in the air. So as we studied in our previous class, trees are very much helpful in maintaining the balance of gases in the air. So forest contains large many number of trees which help in maintaining the balance of gases in the air, and they also protect the soil from erosion, and the roots of the plant hold the soil firmly. They hold the soil tightly so that it stops or it prevents the soil from being washed away by water or being blown away by the wind. Next is wildlife. So what is wildlife? Wildlife means all the organisms living in their natural surroundings are called as wildlife. So organisms are the living beings. So all the living beings which are living in the natural surroundings are called as wildlife. So it includes all the animals, the wild animals that lives in the forest and the animals that lives in the grasslands and the aquatic creatures which lives in the oceans, lakes and the sea. And some of these animals are directly useful to us because we eat them. For example, fish. But there are many other animals, even though they are not directly useful to us, but still they are very important in maintaining the environmental balance. Next, we are going to learn about extinct animals and endangered animals. Children, these two terms are very important in your exam point of view as well as for your practical knowledge. So what are extinct animals? When an organism vanishes from a world, from the place or from the world, then we say that it is an extinct animal. For example, cheetah is no longer found in India. So we say cheetah is extinct in India. So extinct means an organism vanishes. Vanishes means it disappears. It disappears from a place or from the world. We say that it has become extinct. Then what is endangered? When very few animals of a particular kind are left in a place or in the world, we say that it is endangered. For example, the tiger. The tiger is endangered in India, and the endangered organisms can become extinct. So we have to protect them properly. So endangered means very few of a particular kind of organism is left in a place or a world, then we say that it is endangered. Next, we are going to learn about rocks. There are basically three types of rocks: igneous rock, metamorphic rock and sedimentary rock. The igneous rocks are said to be the oldest kind of rock, and these rocks are formed when the top layer of the earth cooled many years ago. So the word igneous comes from a word ignite. So what does ignite means? Ignite means to set fire or to set light to something. So igneous means something connected with light or something connected with fire. So igneous rock was formed many years ago by the hardening of the hot material. Hot fury. Fury means something burning. So igneous rocks were formed by the hardening of hot or burning material, and when the lava from the volcanoes cooled down, the igneous rocks were formed from it. So granite is an igneous rock. We use it as building material. So as you can see in this picture, granite is an igneous rock. Next is sedimentary rocks. So before learning about sedimentary rocks, we must understand what is meant by sediment. So to understand this, we can do a very simple activity. Take a jar containing water and add some soil to the jar and mix it well. After some time, what you can see is most of the soil will settle down at the bottom of the jar. And the soil settled at the bottom is called sediment. So sediment is nothing but the heavy particles get settled at the bottom of water bodies and they are called as sediments. Similarly, many layers of sediment get settled at the bottom of lakes and seas. And these sediments are mainly rock particles which are carried by rainwater and rivers. And they are also formed by the waste of plants and animal. Plants and animal remains, for example, the shells of aquatic animals. And over many years, over million of years, these sediments, they get pressed together and form the sedimentary rock. So common example of sedimentary rocks are sandstone and limestone. So you know, sandstone is used for building purpose, while limestone is used for making lime. The lime mentioned here is not the lemon, the fruit which we get from the tree. It is a kind of rock. The lime which is mentioned here is actually a kind of rock which is white in color and it is rich in calcium. Next, we are going to learn about metamorphic rock. So what is metamorphosis? Metamorphosis means change of form. Meta means change. Morphology or morphosis means form. So metamorphosis means change of form. So when the igneous or sedimentary rocks, when they get buried underground, after many years, after millions of years, they sometimes change into completely different kind of rocks. And this happens because of pressure and heat inside the earth. So the new rocks which are formed from the igneous or sedimentary rocks, they are called as metamorphic rocks. And the common examples are marble and slate, and both of these they are used for building. And some of you would have seen in construction sites, they will be using marbles and sandstone, limestone, granite and slate. But children, have you ever wondered from where do we get all these marbles and granite and slate? Yes, we get all these from rocks which are present under our ground. Next, we are going to learn about metals and non-metals. So again, you may ask me one question, from where do we get the metals and non-metals? So your answer is, we get metals and non-metals from the rocks which are present in our earth. So the rocks are made up of metals and non-metals, and usually these metals and non-metals, they are all mixed up together, so it is very difficult to separate any one kind of metal from the rock. But there are some rocks which have only one kind of, one particular kind of metal or a non-metal. So such rocks are called as ores, O-R-E-S. So we learned that ores are rocks that contain a particular metal or a non-metal. So how can we get these ores? Since the ores are present deep under the ground, can we just dig a hole and get the ores? No, we have to make pit. Okay, so mines are usually the places from where we dig out the ores. So mines can be both open pits or else long tunnels. When the ores lie very deep under the ground, then we have to dig a long tunnel to reach and to get the ore. So after the ores are dug out, so after it is taken out, they have to be purified. Why do we purify the ore? We purify the ore because it usually get mixed up with other substances. So in order to get the particular metal or non-metal, we have to purify it. Then how do we do the purification process? Yes, it is through heating. So what are ores? The rock having a particular type of metal or a non-metal is called ore. How do we obtain ore? They are obtained through mines. Okay, mines are dug to get the ore. So these mines can be either open pits or long tunnels, and the ores are dug out, then they are purified. Then we learned how do we purify. So we purify through the process of heating. So why must we purify? In order to get the metal or non-metal in the purest form, we do the process of purification. So what are some of the common or useful metals we come across? Iron, copper, tin, aluminium. These are some of the common and useful metals. And gold and silver are some of the precious metals we use. Whereas steel is a metal which is obtained from iron. Well, brass and bronze are metals which are obtained by mixing together copper and other metals. So the mixture of metals are called as alloys. So what are alloys? The mixture, when we mix two or more metals together and when we get a mixture of metal, we call it as alloys. Next, we are going to learn about non-metals. And the three important non-metals are phosphorus, sulfur and carbon. So now let's learn the uses of these three non-metals. So first we'll learn about phosphorus. Phosphorus is used to make matchsticks. So you would have seen matchsticks. Your mummy will be using it in your kitchen. So these matchsticks are made up of phosphorus. Since phosphorus can burn very easily, they are used to make matchsticks. Next, phosphorus is very important for the growth of plants. So phosphorus is naturally present in the soil, which the plants absorb in order to grow tall and strong. But sometimes there is a lack of or deficiency of phosphorus in the soil. So that time farmers use fertilizers which contain phosphorus to improve the fertility of the soil so that the plants can grow properly. So next, even we human beings, we need phosphorus for healthy and strong teeth and bones. So we get phosphorus from milk, fish, meat, eggs and pulses. So next, let's learn about sulfur. Sulfur is also a non-metal. It is yellowish in color. It is used to make medicines, fireworks, matches and dyes. It is also used to make the acid in battery. Next, let's learn about carbon. The two forms of carbon are coal and graphite. So you would have seen coal, okay, the black color substance. It is used for burning and it is used as a fuel, and we can even generate electricity from this. And graphite is used to make pencil lead. So the black part, the lead of the pencil, is made from graphite, and graphite is also used to make batteries. So all non-metals, they do not come from rocks. There are some non-metals which are present in air. They are oxygen and nitrogen. Oxygen and nitrogen are two important non-metals that come from the air. Next, we are going to learn about another important natural resource. It is the soil. So plants take water and minerals from the soil. So soil is very important. Without soil, we would have no food. And even many small animals like worms and microorganisms, they live in the soil. So how is soil formed? Soil is formed from rock particles. So usually rocks are very big and soil is very tiny and small. So how was soil formed from rocks? Soil is formed when the rock particles break down. The breakdown of rock is called weathering. So rocks become weak and they crack and break because of heating and cooling. So sometimes the root of the plants, when they penetrate deep into the rock, they break the rock. So these loose pieces of rock, they are further broken when there is rainwater flowing by the rock. So this is how soil is formed from rocks over millions of years. And soil is kept in place by the roots of the plants. If the soil is not covered by plants, then what will happen? It will be easily eroded away. The soil will be easily carried away if there is a heavy rainfall or a wind. Next is fuels. Coal, petroleum and natural gas are called the fuels, and they give us energy which we use for driving the vehicles, for running factories. So what do we use for driving vehicles? We use diesel, petrol for driving vehicles, which we get from petroleum, which is a fuel. And running factories, we again use fuels. For producing electricity, we use fuels. Even for cooking food, the gas cylinder we use is from the fuel. So they all come from under the ground. So first let's see about coal. Coal is a kind of sedimentary rock. So children, just think what we learned about sedimentary rocks. Sedimentary rocks are the rocks that are formed from the sediments which are formed at the bottom of lakes, seas and ocean. They are formed from plants that died and got buried many years ago. So after many years, what will happen is these plants, they get buried deeper and deeper under the ground, under the layer of earth. Slowly, due to pressure and heat changes that happen under the earth, they change themselves into coal. So coal is dug out from mines, like the way we get metals and non-metals. So next is petroleum and natural gas. So both of them, they are found together under the rocks. So usually we get petroleum and natural gas under the seas and oceans. So they are formed when sea organisms die and they get buried for millions of years. So these buried organisms, slowly they form petroleum and natural gas because of the pressure and heat under the earth. And with the help of oil wells, we try to pump out the petroleum from under the ground. And natural gas also come out from these wells. So petroleum is a dark, sticky liquid. It is purified in factories called as refineries. So refineries are factories where petroleum is purified. And some things we get from petroleum are petrol, kerosene, petroleum gas, diesel, grease. All these are the substances we get from petroleum. And petrol and diesel, as you all know, we use for driving the vehicles. We use it as fuel to drive vehicle. So similarly is compressed natural gas, that is CNG, and liquid petroleum gas, which is LPG, and kerosene, they are also used for cooking. So CNG, LPG, kerosene, they are used for cooking. And petroleum is also used to make many things like wax, plastics, some medicines, and even the cosmetics. Your makeup products, cosmetic products are obtained from petroleum. So cosmetics are things used to make the skin and hair beautiful. So to look more beautiful, we apply lots of creams and beauty products, isn't it? So these products are called as cosmetics. They are made from petroleum, which is found, which is obtained under the sea. Next is air and water. So we all know that all living beings, we need oxygen to breathe, and plants use carbon dioxide to prepare food. So there are many other gases also present in the air. For example, nitrogen. So nitrogen is used to fill the food packages. If you would have seen Lay's packet, so there is lot of gas inside the packet. So this gas is mainly nitrogen, which help in preventing the food from getting spoiled. Okay, so the food inside the Lay's packet, it is preserved or it is kept without spoiling because of the nitrogen gas which is filled inside it. Next is water. So again, water we use for many activities like drinking, for cooking, for bathing, for growing crops and for many other things. We can only use the fresh water from the lakes, ponds, rivers, and the water which we get from underground, which is called as ground water, but we cannot use the water from the seas because these are salty water. But still, seas are very important because they are the main source of rain, which plays a very important role in water cycle. In today's class, we studied about the natural resources, from where do we get it and how are they useful to us. So first we learnt about forest and grasslands. Second, we learnt about wildlife. Third, about rocks. Fourth, about metals and non-metals. Fifth, soil. Sixth, fuels. Seventh, air. And eighth one, water. It's time for you to do your assignments now, and don't neglect to complete your classwork notes. Write neatly and legibly in your science classwork. Thank you, children. Have a nice day.